Good morning. I'm Hannah Zentz, and I want to welcome you to Valley this morning. Palm Sunday is a time where we focus on praise. On that day, so many years ago, Jesus rode into Jerusalem while the people shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed be the one who comes in the name of the Lord." They told Jesus to keep the crowd silent, but he responded that even if the people were silent, the rocks would cry out in praise. So although this virus may tell us to be silent in fear, we choose to cry out in praise to our God. The band is here to lead you through the morning worship. My Uncle Lance will be giving the communion meditation, and my dad is here to bring you words of encouragement from God's word. No matter how or when or what happens in the world around us, we will choose to worship.
Praises rising.
Hosanna. Hey, everybody. It's good to be with you today. You know what? During our greeting time last week, I really liked what happened, except for one thing, and hopefully we got that figured out before we started church this morning, and that was that we would all get on one thread rather than multiple threads so that we could easily follow each other. So for our greeting time that's going to happen here in just a minute or so is that Cindy Wilkins is going to get on, and she's going to be the host of the thread. So everybody reply to the first comment that she makes, and then that way we don't have to jump back and forth to find everything. So again, today you have 3 minutes to say hi to as many people as possible, and go.
Even when I cannot see, you are moving. Even when I cannot hear, you are singing over me. Even when I can't hold on, you won't let me go. You are faithful. You are faithful. Hallelujah.
And of course, that it's not the same as hugging somebody. I understand all of that. But I do have to say that I do have a little bit more control of bringing you back into church this way. And I want you to know that I miss all of you very, very much. And I look forward to seeing all of you check in with your post of your fancy Easter dresses next Sunday. Not you guys. You guys can wear suits and ties. But our fancy Easter attire. So as we continue to worship this morning, Hannah's going to lead us in a new song. It's not just a new song for us, but it was just very recently released. And it says so much about the attitude that we can have as Christians.
I choose to worship, I choose to bow. For this pain in the offering, I lay it down. good when life is not. You will always and forever be my song. I build my altar right here and now. In the midst of the darkest night, it won't burn out. For you are perfect, no matter. Joy or the suffering, I sing it loud. I will praise you through the fire, through the storm and through the flood. There is nothing that could ever steal my song. In the valley, you are worthy, you are good when life is not. You
I just need to say that even in the middle of all this stuff, there are some really great things that are happening. I was able to sit in a little bit this past week on Tuesday evening as the men's group got together kind of virtually. They did it through Zoom. I think there were five or six guys who got on, and they're hoping for getting everybody on as weeks go through, and I think that's a great thing. Shout out to Lance Hardy for setting that up. I didn't see it, but I heard that the ladies group is taking a similar track with the whole thing. Just keep connecting. And you know, every week we're getting new viewers to see our church services, and some of them are members of our church who were not able to get on in one week, but they've been able to get on in on successive weeks because we have some guys who are willing to help get people set up if they're having trouble getting everything set up. I want to give a special shout out to Steve Pitchoff for getting a lot of that done. So thanks for that, Steve. And if you know of other people who would like to log in but they're having trouble getting set up, please let us know, and we will do everything that we can to get everybody on board. I did want to share so that you didn't miss some of the things that happened last week during times when people checked in. There's Bill, of course, and his infamous dog. And not to be outdone by Bill, then Christine also has a picture of her with their other dog. These are great pictures, and I love these coming in. Engelharts didn't want to be outdone either, so they just showed their dog. I suppose that's a good thing. People were showing all kinds of different things. There's our friend Emily, who, by the way, I think that last week Emily won the prize for the most comments on all of the threads throughout the course of the church because she was here the whole time. So great job with that, Emma. We're proud of you. Also we had a good friend of ours who I've known for several years in a lot of ways, who's been close with Way and Jean Stevens. Paco, it was great to have you join us last week, and we know that you've checked into a lot of our stuff, and we certainly just want to give you a shout out from here in Loveland. And also, there is, isn't that a nice looking family? I mean, there is just a beautiful family. One of the things that I do want to say is that she's behind the scene, but Lara Cormos is responsible for doing such a great job with the camera. And I am certainly, and I think all of us are just greatly appreciative of that action. There's a couple of our nurses, and we're thankful for the job that they do on the front lines. And then there's, this is probably my favorite young couple. She's very pretty, isn't she? She kind of looks like her daddy. So I think that's a good thing there, too. And then people were showing what was going on in their homes. A couple of people whose homes were set up, ready to have communion together. And if you haven't gotten your stuff ready, I encourage you to do that, because we are going to share in a time of communion just a little bit later. And also, there's another bright and cheery and happy family, and we're glad to see all of these faces. I just wanted to share them with you. It's one of my favorites is that there's the Cronquist girls looking at a really handsome figure on their television set, and I think these are just great things. But out of all the posts that we had last week, I think all of our favorite ones was being able to congratulate Eddie and Diana on their incredible news, and we are sure happy for them, and we keep them in our prayers as they go through that time. This is, of course, the first Sunday of the month, and so all of us guys have on our guys group shirts. I'm sure that all of you at home have your guys group shirts on, but I want you to know that it's not just something that we do, that this is now becoming something. I'll come back to these couple in just a second. But this is something that's just going on in a whole bunch of different places. That guy is a semi-handsome guy. You know, he bears a family resemblance. But I want you to notice the shirt there. But more importantly than that, I want you to notice the minister's name there at the bottom of the picture. What a wonderful thing that we have to hang on. A couple things is continue to do your Bible reading in the digging deeper as we go through that, because that has just been a great way for us to stay on board. And also, I want to encourage you too that if you haven't done so, keep watching the episodes of The Chosen. Those have been some really great things. And you know, if your kids didn't see episode 3, which happened early in the week, I want to encourage you to go back and watch that episode with the kids. And very importantly, thank you, Cindy, for organizing all of that. And thank you, Christine, for continuing to post all those anti-fear verses. Those are important to us, especially now as we're in a time of celebration. And I'll be honest with you, I'm going to steal the verse that Jared used for his communion meditation last week, because I think it's such an important verse for us to commit to our hearts at this time. Because Paul told the Roman Christians, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. At just the right time. God has it all under control, and he knows what the right time is. But notice that even when it happens at the right time, it's a costly proposition, because it costs God a lot. It costs God his son, Jesus. And we think about Jesus now as we start preparing our hearts as we move towards the time of communion. What can take a dying man to raise him up to life again? What can heal a wounded soul And what can make us white as snow? What can fill the emptiness? What can mend our brokenness? Our brokenness. Mighty, awesome, wonderful is the holy cross, where the Lamb laid down his life to lift us from the foe. Mighty power of the cross.
What restores our faith in God? What reveals the Father's love? What can lead the wayward home? What can melt a heart of stone?
What can free the guilty ones? What can save and overcome?
Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9 tells us that we are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. These are very trying and very difficult times where many are losing their jobs or many are afraid of what's going to happen next. You wake up in the morning and you hear the news and it all seems to be negative. You hear of a friend being sick or someone's losing their job. And these are scary times, to say the least. I'm thinking of this past week of a story in Scripture about Elijah the prophet on Mount Carmel. And it's there on the mount, if you're familiar with the story, that Elijah experiences a great victory one like no one has ever experienced before. In fact, it's very apparent that God is at work. Elijah leaves the mount and he finds himself alone, finds himself scared, not knowing what's going to happen next. And a meeting happens with God. There's a great fire, but Scripture says that God wasn't in the fire. There's a great earthquake. Scripture says that God wasn't in the earthquake. Finally, a gentle, still, small voice. And that is the relationship that Elijah has with God. And that's the relationship that we have with God. But we wonder, why in our times of fear, our times of confusion, our times of distress, does God come in a small, still voice? Wouldn't it make more sense if those times that we were afraid that God made himself apparent? Well, it was illustrated to me this way, that God chooses the still small voice because he's right there. He's right there next to you. He's right there in the midst of your fears, in the midst of your concerns, in the midst of your worries. That's why that Chris Tomlin would pen words such as, "In the quiet hour I wait, only for you I want to hear you more." That's why the psalmist would write, "Be still and know that I am God." That's why in Exodus chapter 14, verse 14, we read God saying, "You be still, and I will fight for you." That's the hope, and that's the truth that we have, is that in the midst of our worries, in the midst of our fears, in the midst of our concerns, God says, "I'm right here. I'm with you. All we need to do is just listen." The Apostle Paul would write, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God." That is our hope, and that is our promise. Let's pray. Most gracious God, thank you for your love, for your being with us in our times of fear, our times of concern. God, we're in the midst of some scary times, but we know that you're right there, that you're right there just saying, "Listen." God, we pray for your hand to heal our land and to watch over us, to guide us, to be with us. Thank you, God, for promising us that you will never leave us. For it's in your son's name that we pray, who conquers everything. Amen.
Hey, Tommy and Eddie here to talk to you about something really great, Palm Sunday.
Yeah, that's the Sunday that we paint our palms purple to commemorate King Saul talking to that palm reader lady, and then we wave them in the air.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
No, it's
yes,
not.
Yes, it is. What Bible do you read?
Palm Sunday commemorates the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. Now picture this. Jesus rode in on a donkey while the crowds put their cloaks and palm branches all over the ground, shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David."
That's what I said. That's what I meant.
Okay, now picture this. Jesus' popularity was going viral. I mean, he just raised Lazarus from the dead in the same community just a few days earlier.
Wait, post-dead Lazarus was maybe at the very first Palm Sunday?
Yeah, probably.
That's so cool. I bet if he was there, he was probably like, "And you're a thriller, thriller, Jesus. You raised me from the dead when you said, get up, get up, get up, ooh!"
Now, to complete all of this, Jesus needed a donkey. Now, you'd think that a king or a prince would ride in on a horse, but not Jesus. He knew the message that he wanted to send. You see, a donkey represents peace. Anybody riding a donkey represented peaceful intentions.
Yeah, it says right here in Matthew 21, it says that Jesus sent two of his disciples to get him a donkey.
Yeah.
Hey, I wonder which two he sent.
Maybe Thomas.
I doubt it. I bet he sent Andrew. Andrew would totally do that. And probably Tony. I bet he sent Andrew and Tony.
Tony's not a disciple.
Oh, sorry. Tony is.
Still not a disciple.
What translation of the Bible do you read?
Jesus needed a donkey, so he asked two disciples to go get him a donkey. He told them they would find one in town, tied there next to a colt.
Yeah. And then he says, "Untie them and bring them to me. And if somebody asks you about it, you tell them the Lord needs them?" Jeez.
Yeah. What?
Well, Jesus told his disciples to go steal a donkey for him.
What Bible do you read? It doesn't say that at all.
I can't figure this out. I mean, Jesus, he changed water into wine. Cool. He fed the 4,000.
He fed the 5,000.
What?
He fed the 5,000.
It doesn't matter.
It does matter. Not the 4th, it's the 5,000.
We're splitting hairs.
I'm sorry.
Jesus fed a large group of people, and that's cool. He healed people with leprosy. He raises Lazarus from the dead, and then boom, he's like, "Hey guys, go steal me a donkey." I'm just saying, I don't think that's very WWJD.
The significance of Jesus riding on a donkey, which he did not steal, was to fulfill the prophecy that is found in Zechariah 9:9.
Yeah, but the...
And the king riding in on a lowly donkey with his way paved with palm branches. The palm branches symbolize triumph or victory.
The what?
The palm branches.
The branch?
Palm branches, Palm Sunday.
I thought it was the palm. They should call it Branch Sunday, because that's confusing. We all have palms with us all the time. I feel bad. I'm sorry, Palm Sunday.
Palm Sunday is a time for us to prepare our hearts for the agony of his passion and the joy of his resurrection. So this week, let's cover the road to the cross with our hearts, our souls, and our minds as we reflect on the final week of Jesus' life.
Let's celebrate in anticipation the return of the King of Kings.
A couple of things as I start. Number one is obvious, is that we're back here in the church building, and I'm glad to be here. And not that I wasn't glad to have you in my family room last Sunday to share in that time. But there were some of you who that while you were there, you kind of left a mess. You didn't clean everything up, and so for some reason, my house was a mess and took me all week to clean up. Now, obviously, that's not true. But it is good to be here because although this building is empty, I can look around and see the seats. I can see where you normally sit. And maybe in some way, I feel like there's a little bit of a connection with you because I can imagine who you are and where you are and share this time together. Second thing I'm thankful for is that I have honest friends. I'm really thankful for that. I was sharing with a friend today about the fact that I didn't feel all that good about my sermon last week. I felt like there were some things that I didn't communicate all that well, some things I could have said better or more clearly. And maybe it was because I was in my family room in front of a fireplace on a rocking chair. I don't know, but I didn't feel all that good. And so I was sharing this with them, and they said, unlike a normal good church person who would say, "Oh no, Pastor, I thought you were great. You're always a blessing to us." And they didn't say that. They said, "Well, you know what? I understand
because it's hard when there aren't people there who are responding. Might as well said, yeah, you kind of stunk last week, but I am thankful. I am so incredibly thankful for honest friends. And so to that end, I promise you this morning that I'm going to try to be a lot more lifelike so that you can get a hold of me. Third thing is, I'm not going to talk about the virus this morning. I'm not going to talk about a Christian perspective or any of those things. I'm simply going to share the good news of Jesus with you this morning. And I am so thankful to do that. And I know that because it's Palm Sunday that many Christians, probably millions of Christians around the globe, will be sharing the same thing and focusing in on what we have come to know as the triumphal entry or Palm Sunday. And maybe we're celebrating this in a unique way, but we are still celebrating. So what I want to do is I want to start with two readings this morning, and they both come from the Anglican Church's liturgical calendar. Now, the fact of the matter is that I'm not Anglican, and I barely know what the word liturgical means, but I thought that these passages were extremely pertinent for us. So let's start in the second chapter of the book of Philippians. Going to start right at the top there. Paul says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. But he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The second reading comes from the 11th chapter of the book of Mark, and this is our focus for this morning. I'm going to start again at the top. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Tell him, the Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly. They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied to a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt? They answered as Jesus had told them, and the people let them go. And when they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. Now Jesus entered Jerusalem and went to the temple. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Heavenly Father, I thank you this morning that you have given me this privilege to share your good news. Father, I humbly acknowledge that I'm unworthy, but I'm amazed at the fact that you choose to use me anyway. So I simply ask that you would make my words your words this morning, my thoughts your thoughts, and that I would be a blessing to my friends. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, I love the story of Palm Sunday. I really do. And it's framed in a couple ways. Number one, it's framed as a part of the last week of Jesus' earthly life, which we call the Passion Week. And it's also framed in the framework of the celebration of Passover. And with these two things in mind, we see that the people are not only looking backwards in thanksgiving to the Passover that got them out of the land of Egypt, but they're also looking forward to the coming Messiah and asking that God would take them that direction. And so what we see here is a celebration of an affirmation. It's a celebration of the affirmation that God is in their midst and that God is working in their lives and that God is present in mankind. You see, they knew what God had done and they hoped for what God was going to do. Now today in our society on Palm Sunday, there are a lot of people who show up for a lot of different reasons. Some people show up maybe out of a sense of escape. Maybe the world around them's gotten them down and maybe they don't know exactly what to do, and so they're thinking, well, I guess I'll go to church because I guess it really can't hurt anything. So they're just trying to escape the moment. Some people come out of a sense of sentimentalism. Maybe they remember the times as they were growing up as a child that they went to church on Palm Sunday, and maybe they received real branches, or maybe they made some out of construction paper or cardboard, and they ran all over the church building just kind of being a nuisance, and they thought, man, that was a great time. And maybe they're sentimental about that whole thing, and that's brought them here today. For some people, maybe it's a sense of skepticism. Maybe they think, well, you know, this church thing, it's okay, but it's only good for children and for old women. And maybe they're so skeptical that they're thinking, maybe I can trip him up or trip them up, and maybe they'll say or think things that reinforce my skepticism. Maybe they take out of context or rewrite the words of Mason Williams, "If I listened long enough to you, I'd find a way to believe that it's not true." Now, I don't know about that. Now, I don't know your heart. I don't know exactly what brings you here today. But I do want you to know that I'm going to tell you the story. And I'm going to approach this story from three different perspectives. The first perspective is the identity of Jesus. Now, I read this story from the Gospel of Mark, and I challenge you to go ahead and read that in the other Gospels, Matthew and Luke and John, because it appears in all of them. Maybe it's in a little different form in this place, but it appears in all of them, and I just encourage you to read that and see the story, see the whole story for yourself, and maybe some you can check up on me and see if I'm quoting things correctly out of those passages, because maybe if it's not in Mark and Luke, maybe it's in Matthew and John. I don't know, but I encourage you to read. You got plenty of time, so you might as well do that. If you're reading Matthew's gospel, for example, Matthew would say that when Jesus came into the city of Jerusalem, that the whole city was stirred. Now, Matthew likes to think about those things because when Jesus was born and the Magi came into town, the story is told that when the Magi came and presented their case in front of King Herod, it says that King Herod and the whole city was troubled. So he takes note of what's going on. And it's interesting. But the fact of the matter is that clearly Jesus has an impact on the city when he enters it. And I would suppose that I would pray that when Jesus enters our city, that he would have an impact on our city. That he would have an impact on all the great cities, not only of our country, but the world, because we so need him to have an impact on us. Our nation needs to see Jesus, and we need to be the ones who take Jesus. We need to be show and tell Christians. We not only need to show them the love of Christ and the compassion of Christ, but we need to tell them why. Because it's not just enough to show, because that can be motivated by a whole lot of things, but they need to know that Jesus is the reason why we do things. Our nation needs that. Now, when Jerusalem was stirred on Palm Sunday, they were asking a question. Who is this guy? Who is this Jesus? It's a question of Jesus's identity. And it's a question that everyone has to come to terms with. Just who is Jesus? You see, the gospel writers give us a great picture here. And it's important to note at this point that they not only give us the fact that Jesus entered into Jerusalem, they also give us the means or the manner of how Jesus comes into this city as well. Let me show you what I mean and why that's important. Because the truth is that there's more to this than meets the eye. But you see, that's the nature of the whole Bible. Because the nature of the Bible is that it all fits together. You don't just take one part and one part. It all fits to, it's like a puzzle. If you take a puzzle piece by itself, one piece alone, it doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. But if you fit it into the whole puzzle itself, then it begins to make sense and begins to show us this great picture. And that's what happens in the Bible. Some of the pieces appear strange, but together they make it all work. Or maybe they're like an online thread, as if you jump out of a side of a thread or you just see part of a thread, maybe you just get a little bit of the conversation or a little bit of the picture, and you don't really understand the whole thing. That's why I tried to fit us all into one thread when we did our greeting and all those things this morning, so that we would get a total picture of everything that's going on. That's what the Bible is like. It's this total thread that gives us the whole story. And quite a story it is. First of all, there's the donkey. And that donkey is an important part. And maybe because the donkey, maybe that's why some churches, or at least some churches used to, like to bring live donkeys onto their stage to be an illustration of what the story was about. I don't know. To be honest with you, I've never quite understood all of that. But that's up to them. They can do whatever they want. But I do know this, is that in our story that Jesus comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey, and that is significant. Significant for several reasons. One of the reasons why is because this is the only time that the Bible ever tells us that Jesus rode anywhere. Every time we see Jesus, he's walking everywhere he goes. And he's never running. He's always walking. He's just kind of walking through life and taking in everything. But in this instance, it tells us that he is riding on a donkey. And Jesus is taking charge here, and he tells his disciples exactly what to do. This is not by chance. It's all part of the thread. Now, the thread begins in the book of Genesis. In that 49th chapter, the 10th verse, talks about the lion's cub of Judah. That's when the tribes are being divided up, and a blessing is given to each tribe. And to the tribe of Judah, he says, "You are like a lion's cub." That's where we get that phrase, the lion of Judah, and that old song that we used to sing, "The lion of Judah breaks every chain, and victory comes again." And I don't know, maybe you don't know that song, but that's one of the older ones that I heard. But it goes on to say, I don't know where it's going. It says, "The scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he comes to whom it belongs." Now, other translations use one single word there, "to whom it belongs," and the word is Shiloh. Shiloh is the ultimate king and kingdom. And it goes on to say, "And the obedience of the nations is his. He will tether his donkey to a vine, his colt to the choicest branch." You see, the king is coming, and he tells us that the king, not only is the king coming, but he tells us why the king is coming. He is coming to unite us all. Can you imagine the first people who read that in the book of Genesis? And their imagination is running wild, and they think, what does this really mean? I mean, what is this really going to look like? This lion cub, the scepter, what is all this going to look like? You see, Jesus making a statement, who he is and why he's come. But just because Jesus is making the statement, it doesn't mean that everybody is catching on. Doesn't mean that everybody understands it all. Now, he's following a pattern of prophecy, but that doesn't mean that they all get it. For example, if we were to go to the book of Zechariah, in the 9th chapter of Zechariah, the 9th verse, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Now, Matthew goes ahead and he tells us, he quotes these verses, and he tells us that this is the fulfillment of that prophecy. You see, Jesus is giving specific instruction, and he is telling his people what to do. And he's telling them how to do it, because he is a king. And throughout history, the king has always had the right to do what he wants to do, because he is the king. But see, the interesting thing is, this is the only time that Jesus is doing this. Many times they tried to make him a king. Many times they tried to force his kingdom to come, but he resisted it. But not now. Now he is orchestrating the events that reveal his kingship. But his kingship isn't the same as they're thinking. It's not the kingship of this world. He's a king who will wear a crown, but it's a crown of thorns. But make no mistake, he is king. It says they laid their cloaks on the donkey. Mark 11, verse 7. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Let's back up a little bit in the story and just think about this and get our minds into the story. Jesus tells them exactly what to do. And so they go into Jerusalem, they start untying the donkey, and just like Jesus had said, somebody says, what are you doing? Why are you untying that donkey? And I can imagine one disciple nudging the other and saying, you know what, that guy said just exactly what Jesus had said he was going to say, so we might as well say the same words that Jesus told us to say. And so they said, look, the king needs it, and he'll get it back to you. And the people were good with that. They let it go. And so they bring the donkey to Jesus. And when they bring the donkey to Jesus, they throw their cloaks over it. That's significant, not because they were trying to give Jesus a softer ride. Not at all. This is another piece of the puzzle, another line in the thread. If you were to go back to the books of 1 and 2 Kings, it tells us all about coronations there and the process of those coronations. And I think of specifically of 2 Kings chapter 9 and the coronation of the king Jehu. See, this is what they did when in the coronation of Jehu, is that they laid their cloaks down in front of him. They were laying down their identity to take on the identity of their king. And then if you look at the books, you in Mark and John, it tells us that Jesus got on the donkey. That's only in the Gospel of Luke, and it's because Luke has a tendency to be really big on details. But it's only in the book of Luke that the attention is given there. And it doesn't say that Jesus got on the donkey. It says they set him on the donkey. Another picture of the authority in a coronation of the king. They enthrone him. But what kind of enthronement? Who is this Jesus? Is he who he said he is? Or is he the invention of some misguided men? Or is he just simply another historical figure who came and went? You see, you have to decide. And I urge you, you have to consider. What does he mean? Is he who he says he is? Well, as the story unfolds, clearly the crowd gets caught up in the whole thing. And says they began laying their own cloaks down. They lay down the branches in the street. And they sing the song of ascents. They sing the song that was for Passover. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the Son of David. Lord, save us, they're saying. They laid down their identity for his kingdom. And you got to answer that question. Who is he? C.S. Lewis said either he is who he says he is, or he was a madman, or worse, he was a liar. One thing he can't be is he can't be just a good teacher. Because, see, a good teacher doesn't go around telling lies. I mean, if he wasn't exactly who he said he is, then he was lying to the people. Or he was deluded and he's not a good, great man to follow. But he is who he says he is. And you got to decide for yourself. Now, the second thing that sticks out to me is not only the identity of Jesus, but the honesty of John. I think there's a curse of familiarity going on here is that We've seen this story so many times that there are some really important things that we miss. This is the 29th time I have preached to Valley Christian Church on Palm Sunday. Before that, there were about a dozen more years at other congregations. Before that, there were student ministries and Bible college. Before that, there was time spent in Sunday school. I've heard the story of Palm Sunday until it comes out my ears. And I think that maybe because of familiarity, maybe I missed this one. Maybe I missed the honesty of John. In the 12th chapter of John's Gospel, the 16th verse, John says, "At first his disciples did not understand all this. Only after Jesus was glorified did they realize that these things had been written about him and that they had done these things to him." You see, John lumps all the disciples together, but he's clearly talking about himself. They didn't get it. They didn't understand, not until it was all over and the Holy Spirit had come into their lives and instructed them in all things. They had participated in the greatest story ever told, and they didn't have the slightest idea of what was really going on. You see, never once did they say, "Hey, you know what we need to do? We need to put Jesus on a donkey because that's what Zechariah says, and so we need to fulfill." They didn't know that. They didn't see what was happening. I love John's honesty. He just didn't get it. And you know what? I think that should be an encouragement to us because we don't get it all. Sometimes I don't think we get it at all. But it's a common thing. It's okay. Jesus feeds 5,000 people. And then just a little bit later, he walks across on the water to them, and they think he's a ghost. Mark records that Jesus was telling them all about what was to come, that he was going to be handed over, that he was going to be crucified. It says they didn't understand. They didn't get it. In the upper room, Jesus says, "Don't be afraid. In my Father's house are many rooms. If that weren't the truth, I wouldn't have told you this. But I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go prepare a place for you, I'm going to come back and I'm going to take you back there so that you will be with me." Thomas hears that. Thomas says, "We don't know where you're going, and we don't know the way." Jesus says, "I am the way." Thomas says, "We don't know the way." At one point, he told them that the time had come for them to see the Father, and that if they had seen him, then they had seen the Father. And so Philip responds by saying, "You know what, just show us the Father, and that will be enough." And it's not going really well for Jesus at this point. They're not all getting on board. It's only after the Holy Spirit comes that they could see what was happening. Before, they could see, but they couldn't see. They could hear, but they couldn't hear. And even though they participated in this whole process, they didn't get it. Now, I don't think we're so different. I think a lot of times we can say things about God by rote. We can quote things, and I'm not sure we really get it. Now, my point's real simple. It's okay to struggle. But the best thing to do is to be honest about the struggle. The Bible tells us that one day we will know in full just as we are known in full, but not right now. And I think it's interesting that the disciples still wrote this down, even though maybe they didn't all get it at the time, but maybe they had jotted these things down. And there's only one reason that would make sense for them writing it down, and it's the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because apart from the resurrection of Jesus, maybe I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit, maybe I'm a week ahead, but apart from the resurrection of Jesus, none of it makes sense. Wouldn't make any sense to say, "Hey, let's write down all this stuff about all this." If the truth is that Jesus is dead and gone, that wouldn't make any sense. But the resurrection makes all the difference. I got one more thing. Not only the identity of Jesus and the honesty of John, but I want to talk to you about the necessity of grace. You see, it took the power of the Holy Spirit to open our eyes, and the same is true for us. It takes the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not enough just to believe that Jesus was a good person, or that he was a real person, or that he was a good teacher. But we have to believe that he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that his name is the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every knee will bow. That the story of Jesus is the story of our salvation. But for us to affirm that story, we can only do that by his grace. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, Paul writes, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich." It's all about him. It's all about what he does. It's all about his grace. You get to Jesus by his grace, this wonderful grace that opens eyes, changes hearts, and causes our lips to sing in praises. But you have to accept it. And that's your choice. You see, you got to choose. I know I have to choose for myself. And the truth is that I can't give praise to something I don't believe. I can't even assent to something that I don't believe in. Last couple of weeks, our nation has, seems like, at least the sports world has gone crazy over the great Tom Brady becoming part of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And I can tell you, I don't care. I don't care about Brady. I don't really care about the Buccaneers. There are some things that I do care about, but not those. And so I'm not going to give praise to that. I'm not going to give assent to that. I don't care. But I believe in Jesus. And I believe that he is a Jesus who by his grace he changes us. And when God comes in and changes us, he lets us see what we've missed. He lets us hear what we've never heard before. And he brings praises to our lips. I got one more story. In the book of Mark, the last story that Mark tells before the triumphal entry, before Palm Sunday, is a story about a man by the name of Bartimaeus. They're in Jericho, not too far from Jerusalem. And Bartimaeus is a man who is blind. And he's heard about Jesus, and he heard that Jesus was in town, and he heard that Jesus was coming. And so he calls out for Jesus to have mercy on him. And the people around him told him to be quiet. Look, Jesus has got too much to do. He can't mess with you. But Jesus looks at Bartimaeus and he comes to him and he touches him and he heals him. And you know what? I'm guessing, and I know I'm just guessing, but I'm guessing that Bartimaeus was in that crowd on Palm Sunday. Because he had been changed. That Jesus had given him sight. And where once he was blind, now he sees. I think that's why Isaiah said in Isaiah 42, verse 6 and 7, "I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles, to open eyes that are blind and to free captives from prison and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness." Who else can give sight to the blind? Who can free the captives? Who can release those who are in darkness? It's only Jesus. It's only Jesus. And it was only when their eyes were opened that the disciples truly got everything that this Palm Sunday story was about. So I got to ask, are your eyes open? Do you get it? See, I can't do it for you. I can't open your eyes for you. But the Holy Spirit can. And the Holy Spirit is looking for those who will allow him to give them sight. And so, my friends, I urge you right now. I urge you. Let your eyes be opened. And let your lips be filled with praise. Gracious Father, thank you for being there always. For seeing us through times when we're frustrated or it seems so tenuous. But you're always there. Father, I pray that your words would penetrate hearts this morning, that you might help those who can't see, help them to see and to know that you are good, to know that you are a God, that you are the mighty God, that all power, all glory, all praise belongs to you. And I pray these things in the power of that name of Jesus, that name above all names. I pray through Jesus. Amen.
Light that shines over everyone. We look to you, we long for you, oh Lord. We behold the rising sun, the earth awakes, your hope has come. We look to you, we long for you. Rise, flood this place. We reach for you, we cling to you, oh Lord. Oh, I'm Lord. Oh, I'm Lord. How majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord, oh, our Lord, how your name in all the earth. Oh, our Lord. Oh, our Lord. How majestic is your name in all the earth.
Okay, and finally, I am very thankful that we do have this way to at least connect at some level. It's good for all of us, and I'm glad that you took the time to check in. And I hope that there are more new people with us, and we're glad that you took the time to be with us this morning. I do want to say one thing is that I fielded several phone calls over the past last couple of weeks concerning offerings for the church. And I want you to know that hopefully by now, I'm recording this on Wednesday, but hopefully by now on our website, there is a way that you will be able to give to the church online. Not one of my favorite things, but it's one of those things that I think is important for us now in this time. And so I just encourage you to take a look at that and give as God leads you. It's been good connecting through technology in a lot of ways, and this has made us rethink some things. And hopefully there are things that we're going to continue. It's not just for now, but things that continue even after this hiatus ends. But we're glad that we're able to do this now. And I know that next week is Easter. It's a special week. And so in the vein of thinking of what's happening during Easter week is that Hannah and Ellie have been working on a little presentation with some of the other young adults for a presentation to share with you on Good Friday. And so we hope to have that posted and ready to go for your viewing on Good Friday. I'll put out more announcements and some posts as that comes up. And finally, as even though there are so many things that have changed, or at least they've changed temporarily, one thing hasn't changed, is that Jesus is risen, and Jesus is Lord, and Lord of all. And I want you to know that I love you all. And Father, I thank you that we've had this time together. And I pray that as we go through the days ahead at when a world around us is so often cowering in fear, that you would use us to be beacons of hope in this dark world. Father, as you give us this day, we simply ask that you would use us as your hands and feet. And that's our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You here, Lord Jesus.